Dear friends, now we are starting with a new subject, the Limitation Act 1963. I got a request to the viewers that while hearing the video lectures, you please have a bare act of the Limitation Act with you so that it will be very easy. Because every word in the statute is important for interpretation. Now, first of all, we have to see how the Limitation Act is arranged. We must have an overview of every statute and then find out how it works. Now, so far as the Limitation Act is concerned, it has got 31 sections and Articles 1 to 137. After the sections, then there is a heading, Periods of Limitation. And that is connected with Sections 2J and Section 3. Now that is subdivided. There are three columns in the article section, articles division of the Limitation Act. Description of the suit, period of limitation, time from which the period begins to run. It is based on these three columns, particularly the third column, time from which the period begins to run. The limitation is calculated and computed. I will explain it to some extent after the introduction is over. And what is the significance of the period of limitation? There are three major items in the Limitation Act. Suits, appeals, and applications. Suits, appeals, and applications. So far as a suit is concerned, there is no question of extension of the period of limitation or condoning the delay in filing the suit. Because Section 5, which speaks of extension of the period of limitation, specifically provides appeals and applications other than an application under Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. So, suit does not come there. So, no court has power to condone the delay in filing the suit. Likewise, no court has power to condone the delay in filing an execution petition or any application under Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Therefore, last day is very important. Say, I have to file a suit against you on the basis of a promissory note or a check or whatever it is. Period of limitation is 3 years. The promissory note is dated 1-1-2020. 1-1-2020. What is the last date I have to file the suit? 3 years is the period of limitation. Time begins to run from the date of promissory note. So, what is the last date for filing the suit? It is 1-1-2023. 1-1-2020 is the date of execution of the promissory note. 3 years is the period of limitation. So, the last date for filing the suit will be 1-1-2023. Why it is so? Why it is not 31-12-2022? 3 years will be over then. Because in computing the period of limitation of 3 years, the day on which the cause of action arises has to be excluded. The day on which the time begins to run has to be excluded. that is contained in Section 12(1) of the Limitation Act. So, Section 5, which provides for extension of the period of limitation, that is generally speaking condonation of delay, applies only to appeals and applications other than an application under Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. It does not apply to suits at all. So, what is the last date we have seen on 1/1/2023 is the last date. While coming to the court for filing the suit, the plaintiff met with an accident and he could file the suit after 1 week. Is the court, has the court jurisdiction to condone the delay? No. Suppose it is an appeal. Appeal is delayed by 1 week or 1 month or 2 months or even 1 year. If there are reasons, the court can condone the delay. No harm. But so far as the suit is concerned, the court has no power to condone delay. That is the importance of the last day for filing. That is the importance of computation of the period of limitation with reference to the articles. That is the significance of the third column in the article portion. So, meticulously we have to calculate, compute. And there are certain principles. Going by the scheme of the Limitation Act. Now, there is extension we have seen. There is exclusion. There is, fresh period of limitation starting. And there is no period of limitation at all, several categories. We will deal with it in while proceeding with the sections. There is extension, there is exclusion, there is fresh period of limitation, and then there is no period of limitation at all. All these occur in the various sections of the Limitation Act. Now, in this lecture series, which may come to nearly 50 episodes, I am not going to deal with each article because by the reading of it, one can understand. There is no point in reading it and explaining. Only when some explanation is required, that article will be dealt with. For example, Article 64 and 65, Article 136. All those things, 137, 135, all those things, explanations are required. Article 64 and 65, very important. So far as the day-to-day life of a lawyer is concerned, it is very important. So we will be dealing with it elaborately while dealing with the subject adverse possession. Apart from that, I do not propose to deal with each and every article in this lecture class. I will be dealing with the principles of limitation, that is all the sections will be covered. Now, what is the principle on which this limitation? Why it is so? Why 3 years? There are periods of limitation up to 30 years period is there for certain suits. 30 years is the maximum time. There are certain items where 30 days is there, 90 days is there, 1 year is there, 3 years are there, 12 years are there, 30 years are also there. Different periods are provided for different types of suits, different types of applications, different types of appeals. For example, for an appeal in a subordinate court, the period of limitation is 30 days, whereas if it is in the High Court, it is 90 days. If it is a suit, proper suit, a suit filed by an indigent person, it is 60 days in the High Court. An appeal under the as an indigent person, 60 days, not 90 days. So all these nuances are there, delicate situations are there. So that we have to be quite aware, first, how to deal with the Limitation Act, how to apply the Limitation Act, how to interpret it. And so far as the client is concerned, how to give the correct advice and help you. That That is the most important thing. So that first of all, we must have an overview of the Limitation Act. Secondly, we must have the knowledge of how the various sections apply. That includes computation of the period of limitation. Then we have to see the various articles as to how, what is a period of limitation, how it applies, etc., etc. And how there may be sometimes, say, a suit for compensation for wrongful arrest or wrongful confinement. The period of limitation in some article is 1 year. But there are special statutes, for example, Delhi establishment, Delhi police establishment. Kerala also, we had a Kerala Police Act. We had, now it is amended. Now, I do not know what is the possession period of limitation. But in the previous police act, it was 6 months. For the same type of suit, for compensation for obtaining illegal arrest and illegally detaining a person, period of limitation provided in the Limitation Act is 1 year. Whereas the period of limitation provided in the Kerala Police Act or Delhi Police Establishments Act is 6 months. How to reconcile? Then what is the principle behind this limitation? First of all, we will deal with that. The doctrine of limitation is based on two broad considerations. One, there is a presumption that a right not exercised for a long time is non-existent. You cannot sleep over your rights and come to the court at any time you want. There are certain prescriptions with reference to the period of limitation. If you want the help of the court to have a suit, you have to come within the period of limitation. And that is based on a Latin maxim, vigilantibus, vigilantibus, non, dormantibus, dormiendibus, jura, subvenient, subvenient. Meaning of it is, laws come to the assistance of the vigilant, but and not to the sleepy. Laws come to the assistance of the vigilant and not of the sleepy. You cannot sleep over your right. If you have got a right and if you want the help of the court to ventilate that your grievance and to have a redressal of your grievance, to have a relief, come to the court within the time prescribed. Second principle is that it is necessary that title to the property and matters of right in general should not be in a state of constant uncertainty, doubt, and suspense. Title to the property and matters of right in general should not be in a state of constant uncertainty, doubt, and suspense. Now please note a decision. AER 1973 Supreme Court 2537. AER 1973 Supreme Court 2537. Rajendra Singh and others versus Shanta Singh and others. The principle laid down, the object of the law of limitation is to prevent disturbance or deprivation of what may have been acquired in equity, justice, by long enjoyment, or what may have been lost by a party's own inaction, negligence, or laches. Please see that decision on what principle this Limitation Act is based. One may feel that is it not harsh that I am entitled to get money under a promissory note executed by you. You borrowed money from me, executed a promissory note. Last date is 1-1-2023, as we see. See, I could file the suit only 1 week thereafter. Should I have a remedy? Should not I have a remedy? Remedy is there if you come to the court before 1-1-2023, as in the example which I have given. So help not to the sleepy. Then the salient features of the Limitation Act 1963. We are having the Limitation Act 1963. Before the 1963 Act, we had 1908 Act, the Indian Limitation Act. Now that Indian is not there, the Limitation Act 1963. What is the salient feature? What are the salient features in this Limitation Act 1963? One, absence of a preamble. There is no preamble here. Then accepting the report of the Law Commission, no illustrations are incorporated in the Act. We have seen in IPC, we will see illustrations. Even in CPC, there are illustrations, rarely. But here, there is no illustration. That is on the basis of the report of the Law Commission. The reason given for such a step is that illustrations were unnecessary and often were misleading. To avoid that. 3. The old Limitation Act regulated suits, appeals, and only some applications. But the present Act applies to suits and other proceedings and for purposes connected therewith. The maximum period, 4. The maximum period of limitation under the 1908 Act was 60 years. For certain types of suits. Now under the 1963 Act, the maximum period under certain articles is 30 years. Suit by a mortgager for redemption or recovery of possession, Article 61. Suit by mortgagee for foreclosure, Article 63. Suits by or on behalf of the government, Article 112, all 30 years. Previously under the 1908 Act, it was 60 years. Now it has been reduced to 30 years. The definition of applicant, plaintiff and defendant have been, definitions of these three terms have been enlarged so as to include not only a person from whom they derive title, but also a person whose estate is represented by an executor, administrator, or other representative. It has been, scope is enhanced. Now, what is the nature of this statute? Is it exhaustive? Is it exhaustive? Let us see the decision AER 1964 Supreme Court 227. 1964 Supreme Court 227. The Limitation Act is a consolidating and amending statute relating to the limitation of suits, appeals and certain types of applications to courts and must therefore be regarded as an exhaustive code. It is an exhaustive code. It is a piece of adjective or procedural law and not of substantive law. So the Limitation Act is not a substantive law, adjective or procedural law. Is it exhaustive? Yes, it is exhaustive. Now there is a latest decision also on that point. That is 2001-4 SEC 713, corresponding, that is parallel citation, AER 2001 Supreme Court 1968, three judges, Syndicate Bank versus Prabha, D, Naik and another. There are several points were discussed. It is a procedural law. Provisions subsisting on the date of institution of the suit would apply to the suit. That is in paragraph 2. It is discussed. Now this is the principle on which. Now I said that there are 31 sections and 137 articles. Let us see how it is subdivided. Articles 1 to 113 relates to suits. And articles 114 to 117 appeals. And articles 118 to 137 applications. Then the suits are subdivided again into 10 classes. Please note, suit relating to accounts, articles 1 to 5. Suits relating to contracts, articles 6 to 55. Suits relating to declarations, articles 56 to 58. Suits relating to decrees and instruments, articles 59 to 60. 5. Suits relating to immovable property, articles 61 to 67. 6. Suit relating to movable property, articles 68 to 71. 7. Suits relating to tort, articles 72 to 91. 8. Suits relating to trusts and trust property, article 92 to 96. And 9. Suits relating to miscellaneous matters, articles 97 to 112. 10. Suits for which there is no prescribed period, article 113. That is, suits are divided into 10 classes, which you will get in the articles which I mentioned. Now, how conveniently the various periods of limitation are to be applied? See, at the time when the act was enacted, can anybody, including the parliament, contemplate all types of suits, appeals? Appeals probably may be possible, but applications and all those things. A particular type of application is prescribed here. And you may file an application and say, no, my application does not come under any of these categories. Such an argument is possible. Therefore, it is not possible in any statute to foresee all the contingencies which may happen in the course of time, in the course of several years. These are all laws which have to stand for years and years together. We cannot at our pleasure amend it and add to it. That will lead to confusion. So that the act must be worded in such a way that it can be applied to times to come, and in the various contingencies which the parties may face, and various interpretations that could be placed on particular aspects. All these are to be borne in mind. So far as a suit is concerned, various suits up to 113, article 112, various suits are referred to. Suits of this nature, that nature, etc., etc., in articles. And article 113, that is part 10, suit for which there is no prescribed period. All other 10 items which I mentioned are various parts in the article portion of the Limitation Act. Part 10, suit for which there is no prescribed period. Article 113, any suit for which no period of limitation is provided elsewhere in the schedule. 3 years. Time begins to run when the right to sue accrues. So that if your suit does not come within any of the categories mentioned in sections 1, articles 1 to 112, it will come under article 113. a suit for which no period of limitation is prescribed elsewhere in the schedule. That is a residuary article, and the period of limitation is 3 years from the date on which the cause of action accrues. What about applications? A similar article is there in Article 137. See the wording. Other applications. Any other application for which no period of limitation is provided elsewhere in this division. 3 years. Time from which the period begins to run when the right to apply accrues. So that nobody can say my application is different. This is not the application under this article. This is not the suit under this article. This is a different one for which the Limitation Act does not provide for any period of limitation. Nobody can argue. If it is a suit, Article 113 is the residuary article which applies. If it is an application, it is 137 which applies. It is an amending and consolidating statute. We will continue in the next episode with the other matters. Thank you.